you for your service to this wonderful country. Thank you so much. So we're going to start this service, as we do every time, with the flames of faith. And we perform this ceremony to promote the universal consciousness of life, which acknowledges that all peoples and all faiths, all sentient beings, come from the one great universal presence that we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of all religious thought and experience, which we honor here today. We light the candle for the Tao, honoring the universal path of harmony and equilibrium, the natural way. We light the candle for the shamanic traditions, honoring the beliefs and the practices of all indigenous peoples, the way of primal spirituality. We light the candle for Hinduism, honoring the path of knowledge, action, and devotion. We light the candle for Judaism, honoring the ethical path of living by sacred law. And eventually we'll get them lit. And we light the candle for all forms of Buddhism, honoring the Four Noble Truths and the path of compassion. We light the candle for all forms of Christianity, honoring the Christ consciousness as the path of love. And we light the candle for all forms of Islam, honoring the path of compliance with the will of God as the highest calling. We light the candle for the universalistic religion of Baha'i, honoring the path of unity and the path of peace. We light the candle for all forms of new thought, honoring that metaphysical path of mental healing through the practice of universal spiritual principles. And as practitioner, Kathy Story lights the last candle. Let it represent the path that brought you here this morning. I invite you to join with me in prayer. So we go within, so we will never be without knowing the truth. And that truth is that there is truly only one divine essence. There is only one infinite intelligence. There is only one first cause to all of creation. There is only one unconditional love, and this one is the life of God, and this one is our life. For we truly are the sacred activity of this beloved energy. We are the light, we are the blessing, we are the joy of spirit. And so this morning I affirm and I decree that all is well. And that each one of us is here on purpose, open and receptive to all the blessings that are ours to receive. The blessings are all there. Now we are open to receive them, for we truly are awakening to our divine nature. And that nature is that we are the expression of spirit. So I speak the truth and it sets us free. It sets us free from any doubts, any worries, any concerns. It sets us free to be the light in the world. It sets us free to be the blessing, to be the love. And so I place my words into that medium of pure subconscious mind, into the love of spirit. knowing that it's already been acted upon as we speak. And so my heart is full of gratitude and deep thankfulness for this time together, for this teaching, for this knowing. And so I anchor this prayer in confidence, in love, and in joy, as together we say,
and so it is.
And someone is coming up to read the affirmation, and it would be Hans Smith.
It is.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Get out of the way. Okay, everybody cool? All right. Okay. I believe in God, one creative intelligence, operating through the universe and operating throughout my entire being, now and always. I believe this perfect spirit operates upon a law of mine and creates my experience exactly according to my belief. I believe this perfect creative intelligence can be used by me and by every other person to produce health, abundance, and love in mind, body, and total life experience. I use it now, and I rejoice in it, and so it is. Good. Okay, and now for our affirmation today. I am so grateful
for my ability to reflect and grow. I am grateful for being aware of my inner conversation. By noticing my monkey mind, my attainment, consciousness,
by self-awareness. And so it is.
Thank you, Hans. And please welcome Debbie Wheeler.
All the colors of the rainbow, all the voices of the wind, every dream that reaches out to find where love begins. Every word in every story, every star in every sky, to testify.
was so powerful, Debbie. Thank you so much. Yep. Ah, testifying to love. What a great idea. Here's love. I'm testifying to it. This week, it's all about feeling blessed for our self-awareness, for knowing what we are, who we are, to be aware of the self. So that's a really slippery slope. I trust that many of you begin your mornings by reading the Science of Mind magazine, the guide, at least the guides. In the Science of Mind magazine this month, Reverend Dr. Petra Weldes has an article that is just exquisite. It's an article about practicing the presence, which is our subtitle for our Wednesday's Wisdom service. But she explains what it means to her, and she gives some practices. So I know Reverend Judy has probably already devoured that article. But I want to read to you a little tidbit from her essay. She said she had studied, and she loved to teach this and explain to other people, and I know some of our teachers and practitioners have experienced the same thing. And so one of the things she started to do was everything she saw should say God after it. You could say divine mind, you could say creative intelligence, it doesn't matter, but she was trying to get it clear in her own consciousness that everything is God. So she'd say piano God, table God, person God, partner God, window God, everything God. And she said, at first it felt silly, it felt stupid. Then somewhere along the line, I got curious. What is it about the thing or person that is God? So then asking those questions would deepen the reflection, the answer. She said, one day I remembered my teacher trying to explain to me the practice of the presence. With tears rolling down my face, I discovered that I had learned how to pray without ceasing. I believe this is what it means to practice, to take any one of our principles and begin to try to experience it as an embodied reality. As I began to examine myself and became aware of all the overall tendency of my thinking and my words, I realized that I was not very good at expressing gratitude or praise, but boy, could I assess and diagnose what was wrong with someone else. As I began to listen to my words outside of my spiritual mind treatments and affirmations, I noticed that I tended to make everything dependent on something outside of myself. I also realized how easily I rationalized, exaggerated, and sometimes downright lied, simply to make myself look good and feel better. I was stunned at how my words were entirely incongruent with the words I spoke in my affirmations and spiritual mind treatments. She is not atypical. If we really look deeply, we will discover similar things. But it has to be, this is the whole blessing of self-awareness, means being fully aware, not just on Sunday, because this is not a teaching that's about Sunday. This is about teaching, about change your thinking, change your life. Not just change it for an hour on Sunday or 15 minutes during the meditation, but change your thinking completely will change your life. That is what we stand upon. And in order to know if we're changing our thinking, we need to be able to look at it, to observe it, without drawing back, without cringing, without going, ooh, ooh, ouch, ouch. It is definitely a practice, and I encourage all of us, starting of course with me, to do it as thoroughly as possible. I have had such an interesting week, a very full week, and I want to first of all begin, so this is for you, Paul. I want to show you my kittens, because I've been talking about these kittens every week. Okay, this is what they look like when I got them. Aren't they darling? The little white one, who's Buzz Lightyear, was 3 pounds when I got him, and the darker one was 3.6 pounds. Now, before we show the next one, Mary, one of the things I did on Thursday was I had an interview. I was interviewed by Wade Wooldridge. And so Wade was in my house, and he was interviewing me on spiritual, really on this my spiritual beliefs, the topic, where my altar, my puja. And so we were sitting at my dining room table, and all of a sudden, my cat not only jumped up on me, but jumped on the table toward Wade's drink. He'd run away when Wade first got there. He disappeared, I thought, and so did his brother. Now, could you show the second one? This is what they look like now. They're huge. When Kimberly saw them, she said, "That isn't a kitten." These kittens are now 6 months old. And you can turn it off, because that's all I wanted to say about the kittens. Except that what I discovered about myself is I love cats and kittens, and it's always been easy for me because they like me, I like them. We are simpatico, we get along together. There's no issues, except I discovered, and Kathy's not gonna like this, but I'm gonna just say what came to me is I'm a bad kitty mom. Because I have raised wild children. It's like I've just abrogated any responsibility to teach them anything and just let them run wild. They're running wild all over the place, on the counters, on the table, still chewing the last thing I discovered that was my lamps no longer works, because that thing is also chewed completely in half. Completely in half, and yes, it was plugged in when they chewed it. That I still have two is quite amazing, because first it was the speakers. But I realized, and that's why I was so glad you started with that song, is for me it's all about love. My desire is to be about love, to be loving, to be kind, to be generous with my love, to be loving, especially of my pets. And hence, my unwillingness to give them the discipline that they need in order to be safe. So it was just something I've learned about myself this morning, and it will be something I'll be working on during the week. This week, finally, the vet is going to come on Friday. I've scheduled him several times, as you know, and because of me, because I couldn't medicate my cats, I haven't seen him yet. So what you will know for me is all day Thursday, they're going to be very hungry kittens because I'm not feeding them, so they will take the medicine. Yeah. And I'm telling you the reason they got so big is because I feed them every time they ask. Up until now, it's like giving the baby the bottle every time she cries. Even though that probably isn't the right thing to do for the baby. It's going to make a fat baby. I have one fat cat, one slender cat that metabolizes everything fast. Like every single thing in life, everything's connected. And as I was looking back on my life, thanks to Wade's help, I was realizing that my way of being has served me in many ways. My way of being, of really trusting that presence of God within me to guide me right, that I will make the right decisions, I will do the right thing, and for the most part, it has been spectacular. It led me here. It led me to my first center. It led me to, it caused me to give up smoking years ago. It's led me to right decisions. And one of the things I both read an article and then I watched a YouTube about a woman who persisted in finding the cure for her husband's disease. He had a superbug And here's their story. They were traveling, which they did often. They were in Egypt, and he got violently ill. He thought he had food poisoning, but come to find out, no, it wasn't. So he was medevaced. They were in Egypt. There weren't any clinics there. There wasn't a hospital. He was medevaced back to Germany, and there was a big tumor in his pancreas, and inside that tumor was the poison of the superbug. And that tumor was really dangerous, and it did spread all through his body, and he was in a coma, complete coma. Everything was shutting down, lungs, heart, every part of his body was shutting down. And his wife was holding his hand, and the doctors and nurses were around them talking and said, "Dude, I wonder if Stephanie knows that he's dying." And she held his hand and she said, "If you want to live, squeeze my hand. And I will do everything in my power to find a cure for this." She had waited a long, long time. And then finally, she felt her hand being squeezed. Now here's the story behind that. He was hallucinating. During this time, he could hear her, but he was hallucinating, and he was hallucinating that he was a snake. He thought, how am I going to squeeze her hand? I'm a snake. I don't have hands to squeeze her head. So then he imagined, I'll just wrap myself around her hand and squeeze that way. So in his hallucination, that was how he squeezed her hand with his hand, was he imagined himself as a snake wrapping around her whole body. Wrapping his whole body around her hand. She pursued, because she was an epidemiologist in San Diego, so studying how, and they were actually, she and her husband were working together, studying the HIV virus and how to prevent certain things. And so she knew about research. And when he squeezed her hand back, she actually said, and this is for you, Clark, "Oh, shit."
Thank you.
Well, because he said he'd never heard someone on the front platform. I was reading something before, but this is a direct quote from her. Her name is Stephanie Patterson. And the reason why, that's because she actually used sewage to discover the cure. She thought and thought and thought, because of superbugs are the result of antibiotics. They've now become immune to antibiotics. Antibiotics can't touch them. They just actually increase their ferocity. So she knew that that wasn't going to work. But she also remembered studying something about a Canadian doctor who had used this before the invention of penicillin. So before World War II, she had read it. She wasn't that old that she could, but she read about it. That he had done some work using sewage, and the things in there, the viruses within there are called phages. And the phages, specific ones, will attack bacteria. So she said to the director of the hospital, she said, "If I can find this, would you see that it's administered to my husband?" He was basically dead already. I mean, everything was shutting down, and there was no hope of any other treatment. So he said, "Yes, and I can point you to some other researchers." So he got her in touch with actually the Navy, because they were researching things. And so she had people all over the world searching for this certain phage that would work on this particular superbug. And this superbug was called the Arachibacterium, because it was common for soldiers coming back from Iraq to have this bug. Wow. Anyway, after many, many months, he was in the hospital, I think, unconscious for 4 months, but he was being looked after. In the YouTube video, you actually see him come on stage with her.
Oh, wow.
completely healed, walking. He had to learn how to walk, talk, swallow, eat, everything. Everything had to be relearned. It was as if he'd had, well, it is as if he'd had a stroke, but there Lorianne is videoing me, and what I know is that people who have had strokes can help themselves heal from the effects of those strokes. And he had big help. He had his wife, who had made a promise, I'll do everything in my power to find a cure. So her self-awareness was about keeping her word, about saying when she sent something to her husband that she would do it. And that reminded me of one of my favorite quotes, which is a very inspiring quote. W.H. Murray wrote this in his book. W.H. Murray was a Scottish explorer, and he was going to go to the climb Mount Everest. But he got there, he got up partway, didn't make it to the top. But he had been a prisoner of war in World War II, and during his imprisonment, he spent every day planning. Every day, imagining himself going up that mountain or other mountains that he had hiked before. And here's what he said. Until one is committed, there is hesitancy, the chance to draw back. Concerning all acts of initiative and creation, there is one elementary truth, the ignorance of which kills countless ideas and splendid plans. That the moment one definitely commits oneself, then providence moves too. So truly, it's up to you. It's up to me. It's up to that place where I am deciding right now that this is for me. This is what I'm going to do. As Stephanie did, I'm going to find a cure for this, which she did. And it's not so easy because evidently each of those phages only, it has to be the specific one. They won't attack any bacteria. It's just the one that they're created for. When I was thinking about this, I was thinking, what a marvelous universe we live in. First of all, it's symbiotic. The trees breathe out oxygen and breathe in carbon dioxide. We do the opposite. How wonderful. And even the bacteria have viruses that can, so everything is supported to be whole. Everything, the plan, if there was one, and I don't believe there is one that way, but it's a perfect orderly universe. Perfect order. So when I say I'm a bad kitty mommy, what I'm really saying is I'm going to do my best this week to bring along with that love some discipline so that those babies grow up to be a year old. They're 6 months now. I think this is a really dangerous part of their life, the way it's been going so far. So a year old, I think they'll be safe and I'll let them go wild again. But right now, some discipline would be good. In this book, I referred to it last week. I'm just taken with this writing of Rachel Naomi Riemann. She speaks right from her heart to the heart of her audience about her personal experiences. And the story I want to tell you today is a story called With New Eyes. And she was working, one of her clients was a cancer surgeon. And he'd really had enough of his work. He was burnt out. He said things to her like, I'm going to find the same thing I did with the last person, with the last patient, it's going to say, there's nothing, I know what's going to happen, and it's depressing. He was actually in deep depression. And she was working with him as a therapist, but also she was guiding him in. So she was helping with various things. And she said, I'm going to give you an assignment. It'll take 15 minutes every night. 15 minutes every night. You know it's going to be something that he has to do inner work, right? And do it as fully as you can. And let me know how it goes. So the thing is that she said, at night, relax, get a notebook, and write these three questions. What surprised you today? What moved or touched you today? Second question. And third question, what inspired you today? So, what surprised you? What moved you? What inspired you? 3 days later, he called her up and said, the answers are nothing, nothing, and nothing. She just let it be. They worked together in other, he came and visited her, but they never mentioned the journaling again. Until one day, a few months later, he comes in with a bound notebook. He said, for a long time, it was all about cancer. It was all about what I was seeing in my patients. It was all about my work. And it annoyed me. And I think she said, maybe you're asking from the wrong place. What if you were a novelist or a poet? What would be the questions you would ask then? What would you look for then? And he said, he started seeing his patients as people. And the first one he talked about was a 38-year-old who had had very aggressive, well, first of all, surgery, and then very aggressive chemotherapy. And she had two children that came with her to a follow-up visit, a 4-year-old and a 2-year-old. And he said he looked at those children, and they were clean. They were very well loved, very well looked after. And I realized that would have been very difficult for her to care for these two little ones, given what she had just gone through. So he said, I told her that same will that helps her be such a good mother, he said, I can see you're a good mother. That same will help you get better.
Yeah.
And the light went off. It's what's gone. We'll help you get better. So he said, and she smiled at him, thank you. He realized in that moment that was the first time he had seen this patient smile. He was starting to be aware of not just his work, but of himself and his patients as people. So the next time he came to see Dr. Raymond, he said, I've changed. There's something about me that is different. And she could feel it. He said, I'm interested in my patients, and they seem to be happier. They seem to be happier. For the first time in his wonderful medical career, not only was he having all the data of the success of his surgeries, but he was getting feedback from his patients about how much they loved him and appreciated him, and even gifts he was getting. And so he showed Dr. Riemann, he pulled out a stethoscope that one of his patients had given him, and the patient had it engraved with his name. And she called him Dr. X all through to protect his privacy, but obviously it was engraved with his real name. And she said, yes, and Dr. X, what is a stethoscope for? It's to listen to hearts, of course. It's to listen to hearts. And that is a huge turning point, to be willing to take that self-awareness from the wonderful skill you have as the scientist you are, but also to the depth of difference you make just by being. And Dr. Raymond's point was, all of us have gifts that we give, not, it might not be what we're trained for, but by our presence, by listening, by being with people, we make a difference. So this week, I encourage you to become even more self-aware than you've been, to listen to your conversation, to listen to that inner conversation, and if it's the monkey, tame him. Bring him in. Notice you are the one in charge of what goes on in your mind, no one else. And that monkey can be trained, he can be calmed, he can be disciplined, and he can be loved. Because, yes, I still believe that love is all we need. It's my story and it's sticking to me. And so it is. Let's join together in prayer. In this moment right now, neither looking forward nor back, knowing that this moment is enough, that's sufficient for everything that's desired, I speak my word. I know that there is only one presence, one power, one life, and I call that power God. It is that certain something that is responding impeccably at every moment. It is that perfect law that is saying yes to the sum total of consciousness. For me, always, I'm looking at the reflection of my inner ideas are reflected back to me as people, as relationships, as health, as pets, as life, as prosperity. All of it is connected in the oneness. Each one of us is whole, complete, and perfect. And so what I know for myself, I know for each one. I know that this is the absolute perfect time to make a decision to love yourself enough to pay attention to that inner dialogue, to listen to what it's being said, not to judge it, but just to be present. Is this what you want to create? Or is it something greater, grander, more loving, more complete, more whole? If whatever it is that you're creating is good because it's God. So what I know of this moment is a blessing for each one of us. I know our self-awareness grows because we have given up that victim story, that worst case scenario. We're letting it go. And we are instead embracing a best case scenario, a case of goodness, a case of godness, a case of loving kindness and well-being. I'm so very grateful for knowing what I know. I'm grateful for the wholeness that I am. I'm grateful for the prosperity that I am. I'm grateful for the good medicine that is mine and is each one's. So with my heart filled with gratitude, I simply place this word in the law of mind. It's complete. And please help me by saying with me,
and so it is.
And now, Debbie Wheeler.
I love that this is a perfectly ordered universe. And some of my own self-awareness and learning in this life, especially as I look backwards and check it out, it's like that old story about the kid that's in the room and he's shoveling out manure, and they say, what are you doing? And he says, well, there's a pony in here someplace. And so I think the awareness that I've grown into and the reflection that I've discovered in my life is that there's a blessing in all things, because it's all piano, God, person, God, chair, God. This is a song called Blessings. We pray for blessings, we pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray God's mighty hand will heal our suffering. Yet all the while, love hears our spoken need and loves us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if God's blessings come through raindrops? What if the healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know God's near? What if the trials of this life are God's blessings in disguise? As if every word we've heard is not enough. And all the while, you hear a spoken plea, and long that we have faith to believe. 'Cause what if God's blessings come through raindrops?
Best choices, my goodness.
It's time for this for us to share our gifts, our tithes, our offerings, that the stewards would come forward. And how we do this is we read our prosperity affirmation together, and then we have a few seconds of silence, and then we're singing a song that we sang in the minister's gathering that I was at, which I really, we sang it and sang it and sang it. I Send My Love. And so it's the perfect song, and then Diane was going to do something after that. Okay, so please join me. My offering is my acceptance of God as the source of my supply, and symbolizes my faith in the abundant flow of this supply.
Heaven that lights our way home, like the flower that shattered the Those of you who are in service today or have been this week, please stand so we can give you a lot of love. And if the practitioners would remain standing, our practitioners are trained in the art and science of affirmative prayer. It's so nice to see you. You're up in the front. Almost every Sunday, she's working, so we don't see her. She's somewhere at the back. So anyway, and the people in, if you want a life transformed, make an appointment to see one of these people. You'll be so happy you did. People who are in service today, Hans Smith, Jill Burnett, Anita Baroldi, and I'm missing. You'll find them either at the affirmative prayer table or in the tranquility room after service for a brief snapshot of what they do in a session. If you're here for the very first time, we have a gift for you, and all you need to do is acknowledge that's you. And we've got one that already identified. Thank you so much. I'm so happy you're here. We're going to acknowledge you. No, it's your first time here in this building, for sure. We're going to acknowledge you, so we're going to affirm. So, congregation, please repeat after me. Something wonderful is happening today.
Something wonderful is happening today.
It's this thing called God.
It's this thing called God.
God in you.
God in you.
God as you.
God as you.
God for you.
God for you.
Welcome home.
Welcome home.
So happy you're here today. There's some information about us, and if you fill out that envelope, it does multiple things for you. It gives you another gift, but it also puts you on our list, so you get our email and our phone calls, etc. If you want. Okay, and do we have announcements?
Well, of course.
Okay.
Yes. Today's announcements are brought to you by the law firm of Fear, Uncertainty, and Doubt, by Monkey Mind LLC, and by your national news providers.
God willing and the creek don't rise, at noon today you can join Conscious Connection right here in the sanctuary for a brief discussion about today's topic. Barring any interruptions from alien invasions, childcare will be available.
Assuming an asteroid does not impact the Earth and wipe out life as we know it, our parent forum is now scheduled for every second Wednesday from 11:30 to 1.
Well, that escalated quickly.
The next meeting is this week, on November 13th. The Parent Forum is a discussion for parents and grandparents who want to interact with children in a more spiritually centered way. Assuming there is not a plague of locusts and frogs, a light lunch and childcare will be provided. If you have any questions, please speak to Lisa McClure.
Well, and assuming there's not a global pandemic that kills everyone in the next 3 days, this week at Wednesday's Wisdom, Reverend Carla and Dave will team up once again to present Life is Better When You Are Laughing. Unless the electrical grid is disrupted by terrorist activity, it will start at 7 p.m.
Barring martial law imposed for the zombie apocalypse, for Wednesday's Wisdom on November 27th, we'll celebrate Thanksgiving Eve together. Bring your gratitude list and a GMO-free dessert to share. It's always a special evening.
Well, I am thankful that we haven't had the big one yet and California hasn't sunk into the Pacific Ocean.
And as long as Christmas isn't canceled because of the global economic collapse and rioting in the streets, you creative types who make things you'd like to sell at our holiday boutique on December 8th can still sign up on the kiosk. Reverend Karen's not here today, but assuming she makes it back, you can talk to her about any questions you might have.
Well, I think that covers the worst case scenarios. The best case scenario is that there's always a lot going on here at the center. Shifting Sands, One Spirit, Men's Group, Women's Circle, Coming Home, Awakening to Spirit, and Circle of Love. So as long as you don't suffer from spontaneous human combustion, take your insert home with you and look it over.
Now watch out. Here come the Mongol hordes.